Well, Bishop Barron just blocked me on Twitter yesterday, and I just wanted to come on and explain why I think that is, and also to kind of go through the disagreements, theological, that His Excellency Bishop Barron and I have. And also I wanted to go through the theological points, the errors that are in Bishop Barron's mind, how he thinks incorrectly. And I've been kind of being more vocal about it, and I think he finally had enough, so he blocked me. But that's okay. I'm not going to stop. I'm going to keep saying these things. Canon 212 in the Code of Canon Law says that we lay people have the right under canon law to voice our questions and our concerns to the prelates of the church. So it's enshrined in canon law, and that's all we're doing here. These are not attacks on Bishop Barron or the bishops of California. We are asking for action. That's it. So today I'm going to go through the controversy. In case you haven't watched the last two shows, in the last two shows, I mentioned the California bishops and the destruction of statues of Junipero Serra in California. And I was just saying, hey, let's get some clerical leadership out there. Let's get out there. Barron's got a huge platform. Let's use that. Let's mobilize the troops. Our bishops can be our leaders and can do something heroic in this great time of political confusion. And I think that was a bit too much for His Excellency Bishop Robert Barron, because I'm blocked. So we are going to begin with prayer, and we'll pray the prayer that our Lord Jesus Christ and Savior gave us. And we're going to pray it in Latin, as we always do, and we're going to pray it for Bishop Robert Barron. So, oremus. In nomine Patris et Filii et Spiritus Sancti. Amen. Pater noster, qui est in caeli, sanctificetur nomen tuum, adveniat regnum tuum, fiat voluntas tua, sicut in cielo et in terra, panem nostrum quotidianum da nobis odie, et dimitte nobis debita nostra, sicut et nos dimittimus debitoribus nostris, et ne nos inducas in tentationem, sed libera nos a malo. Amen. And Almighty God, you are gracious to all of us, and we ask that you would pour out your grace upon everyone watching, upon myself, and in a special way upon your bishop, His Excellency Bishop Robert Barron, that we would all be guided into perfect truth, perfect orthodoxy, and perfect charity in your Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. We pray in his name. Amen. In nomine Patris et Filii et Spiritus Sancti. Amen. Okay. Well, everything, not that it started with this tweet, there's been some exchange in the past. I met Bishop Robert Barron back when he was not a bishop, when he was a priest at Mundelein Seminary. I was giving some talks at a priest retreat at Mundelein Seminary, and one day he came and sat with us. It was all priests, just I was a layman. And he came and sat with us, spent a couple hours and had lunch, met him then. This was before I think he was really famous. I think this might have been maybe 2010, 2011. I'm just guessing. That's the first time I met, first and only time I've met Bishop Barron. And then throughout the years, there's been some exchanges online, and I've had the same concerns that other people have had, primarily his endorsement of von Balthasar's Dare We Hope theology. As you know, if you watch my channel, I think Bishop Barron's endorsement of this aberrant theology, I would call heretical theology, is extremely dangerous in the life of the church. It's why we never hear sermons on hell. It's why people are not concerned about mortal sin. It's why there are hardly any confessions held during the week, because people are not concerned about the damnation that could await them. Because we have this idea from Balthasar. Here's the book, Forward, by Father Robert Barron, Dare We Hope. We have this idea that we can hope, which is a virtue, by the way, that we can hope that all men be saved from Judas on down. And I want to read you this passage just so you know I'm not exaggerating things or making things up, or I'm trying to be a mean guy or score points. This is from the foreword by then Father Barron. And he talks about how great the Nouvelle Théologie is, the Ressourcement, and how Augustine was wrong and he needed to be corrected by the heretic Origen. This is very concerning. Listen to this. This is Barron. I believe it is fair to say that the recovery of these elements brought about through the Nouvelle Théologie's thoroughgoing ressourcement, both biblical and patristic, contributed to a development of doctrine in regard to the issue under consideration. We're talking about Dare We Hope. Bishop Barron goes on to say, without ever embracing Origen's apokatastasis panton, that means the restoration of all, the salvation of all, Balthasar effected a sort of originizing of Augustine, a nuancing of the Massa Damnata theology that by the early 20th century was found increasingly incredible and indeed unscriptural. And then he goes on to talk about the merits of Lumen Gentium in Vatican II. So here he's saying that the theology of Augustine, which included the Massa Damnata, the Massa Damnata is the mass of the damned, the people, the grouping of the people who are damned. And it is, we know that from Christ. He says on the final day, he'll separate the sheep from the goats. He says there will people who will say, depart from me, I never knew you. He says it would have been better if Judas had not been born. If Judas went to heaven, that statement makes no sense. We read the book of Revelation, the Apocalypse, and we see countless people damned, including the false prophet and the beast, the Antichrist. So it's all over sacred scripture that there are and will be damned people. And we also know that it's a real possibility for me and for you. If we do not correspond with the love of God, we do not have faith, we do not have hope, we cannot be saved. But Barron says that by the 1900s, this theology was increasingly incredible. So we got to change that theology. Guess that's what Barron's saying. Then he goes on. Not only does he have to knock Augustine, but he knocks Thomas Aquinas. The most striking and original contribution that Balthasar makes to this discussion, I believe, is his critique of Thomas Aquinas' view, etc. Okay, so Barron basically, in the foreword of this book, is saying we need to originize, that is, take a heretic, Origen, and fix Augustine, and then we need Balthasar's critique of Thomas Aquinas. I say, no thank you, I'll take Augustine and St. Thomas Aquinas every single day. So this is up until now been the interchange that Bishop Barron and I have had. And he's stated that, and I've invited him to dialogue, and he said, I'm not going to give that guy a platform because of my book, Infiltration. Now, the last couple days, I've done the videos on the tearing down of the statues in California. I don't know about you, but it drives me mad to see the statues of the saints torn down and dragged, red paint poured upon them. So people started asking Barron and the California bishops, what are you going to do? You got to do something. You can't just sit in your rectory and watch this happen. So on the screen, you'll see a tweet. This is Nicole Early Gray. She shared this publicly. Great, another letter. What action are you going to do? It's time to go into the streets, to talk in person with Antifa and BLM. You also need to get men out and stand guard around any other valuable statues. Yesterday, I put up a 3-point action plan on what people can do. I also talked about the great Saint Theodosia. Do I still have her picture here? Let me see. The great Theodosia. Here she is. This is wonderful. Theodosia. She was in Constantinople in the 700s. The emperor was going to rip down a famous icon of Christ on the gate of Constantinople. She ran out there, the nun, shook the ladder. The man taking down the icon died. They punished her by hammering a ram's horn into her throat and killed her. After the Second Council of Nicaea, they realized that, of course, icons and their veneration are thoroughly orthodox. It's the way to go. And so they declared her a martyr and a saint. And I'm saying this lady, Theodosia, this holy saint nun, is our patron. We need to be out there protecting the icons, images, stained glass murals, and statues of the saints. And I don't understand why I have to be the one on YouTube saying it. Bishop Barron? It's frustrating. He has a much bigger platform than I do. He has a full videography team. They could have put out a 20-part series by now. So what was Bishop Barron's reply? You can see it over here. It's on my right shoulder. He says, Bishop Barron, that's the lady's job! You are meant to sanctify the public space. The bishops aren't police officers or politicians or community organizers. Vatican II taught that the secular arena belongs to the laity, end quote. Really? Notice how he uses Vatican II and he hides behind it. It's sort of like he takes off his mitre, pulls out a magic wand, waves it over the mitre, and he reaches into the mitre and he pulls out Vatican II. I don't have to do anything. You know why? Because Vatican II. So when I saw this response, I sent Barron a tweet. And this is kind of what I think led to the block. That's not it. Let's see here. Maybe this is it. Yeah, here it is. I sent Barron this tweet after he said that. I said, "Dear Bishop Barron, Your Excellency, could you please point me to the passage in Vatican II that says statues of saints belong to the secular arena and that bishops should do nothing while laymen do everything to protect them?" ? That was my tweet. That's what got me blocked. Because I just want to know, Bishop Barron, teach me about Vatican II. Teach me where it says in Vatican II that statues of saints belong to the secular realm and it's all up to us, not bishops and priests. Y'all just do, I guess Barron believes, y'all just do sacraments. And then we got to go out and fight, which I agree. We're willing to do it, but we need some leadership. We need some shepherds to guide us in how to do this. We don't want to be messed up. We don't want to do something that's immoral, unchristian. Lead us in what to do. Should we be like Saint Theodosia? These are questions we have. We need shepherds and pastors to answer our question. So I said, "Your Excellency, could you show me in Vatican II where it says statues of saints belong to the secular arena and that bishops should do nothing while laymen do everything to protect them?" Boom. Blocked. I got blocked. That was it. End of dialogue. No accompaniment. That was it. I'm not offended, but I am concerned. It's not just Bishop Barron. Bishop Barron is the most visible because he has a huge apostolate. He's got Word on Fire. He's doing the Word on Fire Bible. He's got the Catholicism DVD sets. He's very visible. But in reality, this is a problem across the United States and across the world, that the bishops hide. The bishops don't do their job, and when they're called out on it or it's questioned, they say, "Well, Vatican II." I talked about this last week. It's the Vatican II Joker card. "Hey, Father, it's daily mass. There's only 50 of us here, and I noticed that you have 20 Eucharistic ministers. Is that necessary? I mean, maybe could you just do it? Because there's just 50 of us." "Well, Vatican II." "Hey, Father, could we have Ad Orientem during Lent?" "No, can't do that. Vatican II." "Hey, Father, can I receive communion on the tongue?" "Nope, Vatican II." Everything is Vatican II. It's like a little ace of spades right there in their cassock. It says Vatican II on it. Well, here's your Vatican II card. Anything we don't want to do, it's in Vatican II. And I'm just going to call out Bishop Barron here on YouTube. Barron, you're lying to me. It doesn't say it in Vatican II. I've read Vatican II. You've read Vatican II. Vatican II does not say what you are stating. Yes, it talks about lay people in the secular realm, et cetera. But it doesn't say what you're stating. And I think the reason that you blocked me, Bishop Barron, is because I called you out on it. I'm smart enough. I've read the documents just like you are. I know it's not there. And yet you're trying to trick us. So we called your bluff. And then what'd you do? Vatican II. He issued a document today. It's all about Vatican II, Vatican II. And it's a good thing that Pope Leo the Great, Saint Leo the Great, it's a good thing he didn't have the Vatican II Joker card. Because when Attila the Hun came to the gates of Rome and was going to destroy the entire city of Rome, Leo the Great didn't say, "Well, Vatican II." Leo the Great got his entourage praying, and they went out and they met the heathen warlord. And through the power of grace and persuasion, got him to leave Rome alone. According to Barron, and I guess Vatican II, he should have stayed in his study, worked on his Word on Fire empire, and called upon the Catholic laymen, the lawyers and whatnot, to go out and settle it with Leo the Great. Here's Leo the Great and Attila the Hun. You can see Leo the Great's pointing to the cross. He's like, you know, Attila, I think you need to leave. This is a holy city. This is Rome. And Attila the Hun left. He didn't sack the city. This just shows that the great saints and, I mean, Ambrose went and met Theodosius, the emperor, at the doors of the cathedral and says, no, you're not coming in. You killed a bunch of people in Thessalonica. You got to repent. Not only can you not receive communion, emperor, you can't even come into the church until you fulfill the penance that I, the bishop, impose upon you. The emperor could have killed him right there. We're talking about the Roman emperor. And the Roman emperor bent the knee, received his penance, and re-entered into the Catholic Church under Ambrose. Good thing Ambrose didn't have Vatican II Joker card to pull out and say, well, I can't do anything. I think you lay people need to do something about this. Not my job. I know I carry the crozier and have the mitre, but it's not my job. This is cowardice. I remember in 2000, it was either 6 or 7. I was in Washington, D.C., Catholic Information Center. Cardinal Worrell, I think he was Archbishop Worrell back then. He had allowed Nancy Pelosi to have a victory mass in one of the Catholic churches in D.C. for being Speaker of the House. So I guess this would have been 06. I don't know. Somebody can check the dates. I can't quite remember. But I do remember this part. This sweet lady, like a homeschool lady, was in the back of the assembly. And they did some Q&A. And she somehow got to the mic and she asked her question, Your Excellency, I don't understand why you would give permission for Nancy Pelosi to have a special mass. If you look at her record, she's not pro-life. She's very pro-choice. She's one of the greatest enemies to the pro-life cause. Why would you allow that? And why can't you be vocal in the pro-life movement? And Worrell said, that's not my job. The pro-life movement is the job of the lay people, not the bishops. He said this. I remember thinking, I was a new Catholic. I remember thinking, what? What? I mean, I'm pretty sure you wear the mitre. You wear the crozier. It's true. We're on the ground. We can be activated by the clergy. But we need leadership. We need bishops. Again, I don't want to be making this video. But we need bishops who are going to lead us and lead the charge. It's called spiritual guidance. And we can't just sit and watch churches desecrated, 2 statues of Junipero Serra. We saw today that they're now, Antifa is attacking and targeting the Fraternity of St. Peter Parish in San Diego. We need people to go out there and protect the houses of God. Protect the Blessed Sacrament. Protect images. Remember, it's not about defacing private or public property, these statues. We believe, Council of Nicaea II, Seventh Ecumenical Council, images of saints, Our Lady, and Christ communicate grace. They're sacred objects. We don't worship them. We venerate them. And to destroy them is not just to deface public or private property. It's to commit desecration, sacrilege. This is why I don't understand what Bishop Barron's saying. These are Catholic saint statues. We're not asking Bishop Barron to go out there and talk and defend a statue of Abraham Lincoln. We're talking about Catholic saints. They're attacking our faith, our church, and our Christ. That's the job of the bishops. I don't care how much you wave a magic wand over your mitre, you can't keep pulling out Vatican II as the escape clause. And lay people know it. Lay people know, and we feel betrayed, Bishop Barron. And any bishop who isn't taking a stand. I said in the video yesterday, it's a great moment if you're a priest or a bishop we love that you're celibate because you don't have a wife, you don't have kids, you don't have to worry about paying for private school or college funds, you don't have to worry about the mortgage or your car payment. You're completely free to be a hero. You're completely free. We lay people aren't that free. We want to be heroic, but that's why you guys are celibates. You are completely loaded up to be heroes. And we're sitting here as lay people like, where are the heroes? I mean, this isn't even like Leo the Great and Attila the Hun. We're talking about Attila the Hun. You got to just slice Leo's head off, laughed about it, walked off and just destroyed, raped every woman in Rome, pulled down every single church and burned this, take all the gold and burn the city. That's what Attila the Hun did. That was his Monday. But Leo went out and he changed history because he was brave. He was heroic. Ambrose could have said, well, I don't really know the conscience of Emperor Theodosius. You know, it didn't happen in my diocese, happened out in Thessalonica. It's that bishop's problem, not mine. So I'm not going to really get involved with the emperor if he comes to communion, comes to church, comes to mass. I'm just sort of going to give him communion anyway. No. Ambrose knew this man's soul was in jeopardy, and he brought in the healing balm of excommunication and penance to restore the emperor back to sanctifying grace. Thanks be to God. This is what we're looking for. So I'm going to wrap up. I just wanted to also bring up a couple things about Barron. I've said them before. I think this is a good opportunity since we're focused on Bishop Barron. And that is, I already mentioned that I have a problem with his constant, enthusiastic endorsement of von Balthasar. Dare we hope that all people are saved? He says on camera, I don't know if anyone goes to hell. Barron says that on camera. You can go look it up. But Balthasar, who he endorsed, has some crazy views. Balthasar says, you know, that Christ descended and had solidarity with the damned. That's heresy. We believe Christ descended into hell, but he went to the limbo of the fathers, the Sheol, Abraham's bosom, and delivered the Old Testament saints and brought them to heaven. That's orthodoxy. That's what all the church fathers teach. None of them teach that Christ went to the damned and had solidarity with the damned. That's a heresy of Balthasar that he gets, by the way, via Barth to John Calvin. Calvin teaches something similar. It's all there in Switzerland. Balthasar also has funny things to say about Christology, the Trinity, that the persons of the Trinity are sort of surprising one another. It's very odd. You call out Balthasarians on this and they say, well, it's just theodrama, it's poetry. Look, you can't talk about the Trinity in these poetic terms that sound like heresy. Also, Barron, when he went on Ben Shapiro, this is a big problem. He said Christ is the privileged way. No, Christ is not the privileged way. Ben Shapiro said, hey, I'm a Jew. I'm not a Christian. Does this mean that I'm in trouble, Bishop Barron? And Bishop Barron was like, not necessarily. Ever since Vatican II, notice he pulls out that Vatican II card all the time. He says, Christ is the privileged way. No. Bishop Barron, Christ is not the privileged way. Christ is the only way to the Father. John 14:6, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. That's what Jesus said. He didn't get whipped and scourged and crowned with thorns and carry the cross and get crucified to be the privileged way, to be the fast lane, to be the toll road where you get to skip the traffic and go a little bit faster, a little bit more convenient. No, he's the only highway, the only road, the only passage to the Father. John 14:6. What he should have said, if Barron was on point on this, he could have said, Ben Shapiro, you're Jewish. There's 613 laws in the Old Testament. How are you doing? What's your score? Are you fulfilling the law? Are you righteous in the sight of the Torah? And I imagine Ben Shapiro would be like, well, you know, I do my best. And he could say, because the Apostle Paul, who was also Jewish, said that we can't be justified by the law. This is in Romans and Galatians. And so what you're striving to do by the law, you can never accomplish. And that's why Christ came into Israel. He perfectly fulfilled not only the Ten Commandments, but all the law of the Torah. And by baptism, we are incorporated into Christ, and therefore we are righteous. We become fulfillers of the law by being in Christ. That's what St. Paul says. So Bishop Barron could have said, as a bishop of the Catholic Church, I invite you, Ben Shapiro, to enter into the Messiah, the Christ, and become a fulfiller of the law through Christ. And the way you enter into this reality is through baptism. Ben Shapiro's a smart guy. He knows what Christians believe. He could have accepted that. I mean, he may not have accepted the gospel offer, but at least it would have been legit, biblical, not this Christ is the privileged way. I mean, that's a disappointment right there. And then thousands, millions of people watch that show and they hear a Catholic bishop saying this. It's embarrassing. Also, Barron is a friend of James Martin. Hate to say it, but he is. They work together. They endorse him. James Martin's endorsing him right now, backing him up on this. They're all buddies. It all goes back to Chicago. Barron from Chicago, ordained by Bernardin. It's a Chicago network, and they're all part of it. They're all friends. So I'll end there. Again, Barron's got a bigger platform. I shouldn't be saying this. Barron should be saying this. But maybe Barron thinks, because I'm the layman, I should be doing it, not him. I disagree. Honestly, it should be him, not me. Well, there's the show. Thanks for watching, everyone. If you like this show, I realize this show is a little bit different. If you like it, please hit the thumbs up, the like button. I appreciate that. And the most important thing you do is when you're there next to the thumbs up, hit that share button. And that'll share it on Facebook. That's the best thing you can do, is share this show on Facebook. So if you also have concerns about the statues, about how our bishops are handling or mishandling it, and then also this new idea that because Vatican II, bishops can sit in their rectories, drink apple teenies, work out, but not enter into the fray? What? Really? I don't think so. So if you agree with that, share this on, hit the share button and share it on Facebook. I'd appreciate that. And if you're new, please subscribe. I am live today. And you'll get if you hit subscribe and then hit the bell, you'll get notified every time I go live. If you're on a mobile device, make sure your YouTube notifications are on. But usually I go on live 3 times a week. Lately, I've been going every day because of all the news and everything going on in the world. But please do subscribe. I do appreciate that. And there's a second channel called Taylor Marshall Highlights. This video is a little bit longer, but if you want short clips taken out of these shows, you can subscribe to that second channel, Taylor Marshall Highlights. All right, well, that's a wrap. We're going to pray now, and we're going to pray an Ave Maria. We're going to pray a Glory Be, and here's how I'd like to do it. I'd like to pray the Hail Mary to seek our Blessed Mother to pray for all of our bishops. Every single one in the whole world, not just Barron, all of them. Because we need graces. We need the grace of office to be ignited on fire. We need word on fire. I'm not talking about his apostle. I'm talking about we need their words on fire, like Leo the Great, Ambrose of Milan. So the Hail Mary is going to be for our bishops. And then the Glory Be, the Gloria Patri, is going to be thanking and praising God for the good bishops that we do have. I realize they're a minority, but I don't want anyone to hear me saying all the bishops are bad. They're not. There's good ones out there. We do have heroes. And so we're going to thank God and say Glory Be to the Father, Son, and the Holy Ghost for them. So let us pray. Oremus. Name in nomine Patris et Filii et Spiritus Sancti. Amen. Ave Maria, gratia plena, Dominus tecum. Benedicta tu in mulieribus et benedictus fructus ventris tui, Iesus. Sancta Maria, Mater Dei, or pro nobis peccatoribus, nunc et in hora mortis nostrae. Amen. And now for our good bishops. Gloria Patri, et Filio, et Spiritui Sancto, sic ut erat in principio, et nunc et semper, et in saecula saeculorum. Amen. Almighty God, save souls, save our souls, bring us to repentance, and help us to draw closer to Jesus Christ, our Savior. Amen. Nomine Patris, et Filii, et Spiritus Sancti. Amen. St. Leo the Great, pray for us. St. Ambrose of Milan, pray for us. In nomine Patris et Filii et Spiritus Sancti. Amen. All right. Thanks so much, everyone. Thanks for watching. All the new people, good crowd today. And as I always say, make sure that you are praying the rosary. If you're not praying the rosary, you're not on the team. We need everybody to join together and pray the beads, pray the rosary. This is how we connect with Christ. All the saints, all the popes say, pray the rosary. Our Lady gave it in the 1200s to St. Dominic as the weapon to defeat all heresies. The destruction of sacred images is the heresy of iconoclasm. It must be destroyed. This heresy must be destroyed. So we must take up the rosary and pray. Not all of us can run out to you know, meet the mobs like Leo the Great. All of us can pray the rosary. It's very simple. So pray the rosary each and every day. Stay connected to Jesus Christ. Read the Bible. Receive the sacraments. That is the normative means of salvation. Do the basics and love God. All right. Thanks, everybody, for watching. Remember, our Lord Jesus Christ said you're the light of the world and the salt of the earth. So go out there and be salty. Till tomorrow, God bless and Godspeed.